Friends, let us start with discussion with some questions on DTAA, or you can also call it as a relief under section 91. Okay. Question ID number 1. Let me read the question, baby. A is a musician deriving income from concert performed outside India, ₹50,000. Tax of ₹10,000 was deducted at source in that country where concerts were given. India does not have any agreement with that country for the avoidance of double taxation. Assuming that Indian income of A is ₹290,000, what is the relief due to him under section 91? Explain the relevant provisions of the law. Very simple and introductory question, friends. See, whenever there is avoidance of double taxation, so you have to underline the question very properly, that whether India and that country has got a double taxation avoidance agreement or you do not have. So I already shown you in the BAREC also that section 91 will come only in case where this gentleman is a resident. Now, if you see this particular question, it is not given to us anywhere in the question that whether this gentleman is resident. So it is given to us in the question that Mr. A is a musician deriving income, blah, 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 blah. But it is not given whether this Mr. A is resident. So I have to assume that he is resident. Okay, that is point number one. Second point, remember this small little interpretation of section 6. Very importantly, baby, that resident is interpreted generally by the residential status as resident and ordinarily resident. Keep this in mind, okay? So, this is general interpretation, friends, unless otherwise things are printed in the question. So, A is a musician deriving. Now, we assume that A is a resident, okay, deriving income out of the concert which is performed outside India, okay? So, if you see this, okay, see, gentlemen, he is Mr. A. Mr. A is a resident in India. So, logically, he would be non-resident in the foreign country. However, it may not even be the case, but it is also possible that somebody may be resident in two countries or more than two countries, or non-resident in more than two countries or two countries. It is a possibility, but I'm just assuming. Okay, so resident, he has got outside India income, that is ₹50,000. Okay, tax of 10,000. So on that, in the foreign country, the tax is 10,000. One more point, friends, should be known very properly in the question, that 10,000 was deducted at source. So this 10,000 is basically the TDS of that country. In other words, we have to interpret and assume that the TDS of that country is basically the payment of tax of that particular country. In other words, if the TDS is refundable as per the law of that country, then there is no question of any tax of that country, because TDS is as such not a payment of tax. However, in a question like this, we have to assume that the TDS of that country is basically the tax of that country. So against 50,000, there is a 10,000 tax. So foreign rate, you will easily get it. There will be no problem. Okay. Now further, where the concerts were given, India does not have any agreement with that particular country. So section 91 will come into picture. Okay. And assuming that Indian income is 2,90,000. So Indian income is 2,90,000. What is the relief due to him under section 91? Okay. So you already have a double taxation and you have to give the rebate under section 91. Okay. So this is question ID number 1. Understand, this is the situation where assessee is resident. If you want, this is assumed. Yeah, baby, this is assumed. Okay. And there is no DTAA between India and that country. So this is the situation. This is something which you have to underline in the question very, very properly. Okay. Now, Indian income. Now, the question has become pretty simple. And the examples, friends, which I've already given it to you, should always keep it open. So your basic, your tax rates and multiplication and all the tax liability calculations is pure calculator work, baby. So that you should be doing it very fast, even faster than me now, because my calculation work, my calculator work is pretty slow. Indian income as given to me is 2,90,000. Okay. I have a foreign income. That is 50,000. Total is 340,000. Okay. Now, deductions and all that data is not given, because this is a introductory initial question. So straight away you have to go to the tax liability calculation. You have to give basic exemption. Okay, slab 1, 2, 3. Rebate you have to give on merits. Don't forget that this assessee is resident. So if your income is less than the limit for the rebate, then rebate also you have to give. Okay, so basically you have to give it on the merits. Okay, it's not that always you give or always you don't give. You have to give it on the merits for the resident assessee in the given question. Okay, surcharge on merits, surcharge and cess. Okay, this is what is going to give you the tax liability. And the moment you get the tax liability, friends, you have to get the Indian average rate, Indian average and the foreign average. Now, foreign average actually is small little working. If you want, you can develop that foreign income was 50,000 and foreign tax paid was 10,000. So you get a foreign average rate as 20%. Okay. So if you want, you can develop a small little working note for that. Okay. Whichever rate is less. Okay. Multiplied by the doubly taxed income. Doubly taxed income in the given question is 50,000. So whichever percentage is less. Okay, multiply with 50,000, this will be your rebate under section 91. Rebate under section 91. Don't forget that the rebate under section 91 will be applicable only where assessee is resident and there is no DTAA between India and that country. And that is the title which I have already given. It's a very important title, because once this condition is satisfied, only then section 91 can be applied. Mamma mia. You got to be very, very attentive. Simple question. But these simple things, if you miss out, no, then it's a silly mistakes. Okay. So give this particular rebate, and after rebate, you will get your net tax liability. Okay. So very simple one and a straightforward question. Come on, please update your answer quickly. So one point that you have to also remember, that sometimes because of the rebate, sometimes, I mean, the tax liability may also become nil sometimes. Okay. So ultimately then your Indian rate can become nil. I'm not saying that it will always become nil, but it can become nil. Okay. So in other words, either Indian rate, if it is nil, or supposing if the foreign rate was nil, then anyway, you will not get, because it is Indian rate or the foreign rate, whichever is less. Okay. So there is a possibility, baby, that, these rates can become nil. That's all I'm just trying to say. In other words, you have to give rebates on its own merit. Okay. Now let's go to the next question. Now I will take up one another good question. First of all, before I go ahead with these questions, I want you all guys to come to this page, baby. Yeah, come on, darling. Yeah, come. Now, baby, come to this particular page. Okay, question ID number 3. Okay, a foreign company ST has entered into an agreement with an Indian company KN for the supply of know-how, and the agreement is within the industrial policy conditions laid down by the central government. In the year, 50 lakhs is paid under an agreement to ST by KN. ST claims to have spent 14 lakhs as expense in India to be recognized as a deduction. In the following situation, what will be your decision on the tax liability of the parties? The agreement having been entered into before June 1, 2008 and approved by the government, KN pays to Indian income tax authorities the tax payable by ST. 2. There is no agreement as to KN bearing the tax liability. The royalty payable is decided to be 59 lakhs net of taxes. Come on, go through this particular question, friends. And let me tell you, friends, why did I choose this particular question as a matter of discussion at this point in time? Because this type question, baby, I repeat, mamma mia, I repeat that this type of question is a very old examination type and a very famous questions of those days. Okay. In other words, friends, is a very old examination type question, but it was very famous during those days. And these type question have also got repeated in the exam few of the times, but not frequently. Okay. So, first of all, you understand, and normally students, friends, they fail to understand only this particular question, although it's a very simple question. Once you get the answer of it. Now, a foreign company, ST, so ST is a foreign company, has entered into an agreement with the Indian company. Okay. So, you may say that this foreign company, ST, is a non-resident. Okay. However, foreign company based on the concept of POEM, it can also be resident in India, but unless such facts have been printed in the question, there is no need for us to assume that. All right. So let's say that it's a non-resident foreign company. Okay. Now, with an Indian company, so it has a contract with an Indian company KN for the supply of know-how. Now, when it comes to the know-how transaction, friends, know-how transaction is first of all covered by 115A. It is also covered by section 9. Okay. Now, section 9, if there is any payment of royalty technical fees, and meaning of royalty technical fees includes this particular know-how also. If it is paid by government or an Indian concern, okay, is always deemed to accrue or arise in India. Okay. And if it is paid by Indian concern, then there is one exception. And exception is like unless it was used for the business outside India. However, again, no such facts printed in the question. So I can say that this money, this income of the know-how as a royalty technical fees is deemed to accrue or arise in India because Indian company is always resident in India. Indian company is always resident in India. Okay. So therefore, it's a payment by resident to the non-resident. So by default, it is always taxable in India, except if it was in relation to the business outside India and no such data is given to us in the question. And therefore, it is taxable in India. Okay. Now, know-how agreement is within the industrial policy. The moment it is given, it is within the industrial policy. Straight away, the section 115A comes into picture and special rates of taxes with respect to this particular situation comes into picture. So, first of all, friends, this is a situation where question ID number 3, okay, we are trying to talk about taxation or computation of ST, a non-resident foreign company. Okay, that means in this particular question, friends, section 91 is not applicable. I'm not trying to say that this is a computation of section 91. Reason being that section 91 is a situation where SS is a resident and there is some foreign incomes. And then only section 91 comes into picture. Basically, this particular question is based on the normal taxation of non-resident. So this question is all about taxation of non-resident. Okay. Secondly, friends, nowhere in this particular question, I guess it is printed like India and that country have got some double taxation avoidance agreement or something like that. Let me try to find out that. So normally that these are some of the very basic thing why the questions, this kind of question has often got confused by the students. Okay. In the year 50 lakhs is paid. So that's a know-how payment. That is a royalty technical fees under an agreement to ST, understood. ST claims 14 lakhs as an expense in India, okay, to be recognized as deduction. And what will be your decision to the tax liability of the parties where agreement is approved and all that? So, friends, here there is no DTAA between the countries. There is no DTAA between the countries. There is no such data which has been given to us in the question. Okay. So first of all, section 91 is not applicable. Okay. Then since there is no DTAA between the countries, section 90 or section 90A, which is basically a situation where if there is a DTAA, then you have to follow the DTAA. Even these provisions will not apply. Reason being that there is no DTAA between the countries. So friends, this particular question is something about this kind of situation. See, in this particular question, I will tell you, see, the situation is something like this. See, every computation is pretty simple in this chapter, but you have to identify the situation very properly. SS is a non-resident. Listen very carefully. So this is a situation, SS is a non-resident. Okay. And it has got transaction with some Indian person, but there is no DTAA between the India and that particular country. So this is the situation. Okay. So in this case, your domestic law by and large will be applicable. Basically, it is non-resident special rates of taxes. I mean, and this is something which you have already studied also in the preceding chapters, but you have to identify the situation very properly. Okay. So that is one of the thing here. Okay. Now, as per section 115A, there is a special rates of tax. So first of all, because NOHAV is royalty technical fees. So 115A special rates of tax will come into picture. That will be the first conclusion. Now when moment section 115A comes into picture, this 14 lakh expenditure is not allowed as a reduction because of the specific provision. Also, that also I've already explained it to you in my earlier lectures, because of 115A does not allow you to for expenditure as a deduction here. Okay. In India to be recognized as follows. Okay. So now in the following situation, what will be your answer? Let's come to the question directly now. The agreement been entered into before June 1, 2008 and approved by the government. The main point here is approved by the government. And since it is approved by the government, it is covered by section 115A. And that's the reason the special rates of tax will be applicable. The KN pays, the Indian Income Tax Authorities, the tax payable by ST. I repeat, KN, that means the Indian company pays. I repeat, Indian company pays the tax to the Indian Income Tax Authorities, the tax payable by ST. Okay, so what does this particular statement mean? Listen very carefully. Understand this very, very carefully. Okay, see, normal transaction, you please understand, I'm just ignoring that surcharge and cess, because I'm just giving you a very basic example. Okay, now supposing there is a transaction with a foreign person and that foreign person's income is chargeable to tax in India. In that case, normally TDS is normally always applicable. So supposing if you are paying 100, okay, so you have to, from the 100, you have to deduct the TDS and then you have to make the net payment. Okay. If there is any payment to non-resident of the foreign company with the TDS, you have to include surcharge and the cess on merits. Okay, so applicable surcharge and the applicable cess you will have to consider where there is any such payment to non-resident or the foreign company. That is the part of our section 195, and this also I already explained to you the TDS provision. Okay, now let us assume, I'm just assuming that supposing the rate of TDS for this know-how is supposing 10%. Okay, so out of 110 you will deduct, but with the 10 you will add the surcharge and the cess also. Now I'm just assuming. Supposing if the cess is 4%. Supposing, I just the assumed figure. So your TDS is going to be 10.4. Okay. And your net payment is going to be 89.6. Okay. So what I'm trying to say that whenever you make any payment to the non-resident, and if you have to deduct the taxes per 195, it is not just the TDS rate plus the applicable surcharge and the applicable cess. Here I have just assumed the cess, just for the explanation purpose. Okay, so let me just update this. So normally how do you do the transaction? Okay, 100 minus TDS, you make the net payment. Okay, this is how normally the transaction happens. Okay, but now what happens is the Indian company KN pays to the income tax authorities the tax which is payable by ST. So what you are doing is that you are paying the taxes of the foreign person. Okay. You are paying the taxes of the foreign person. Okay. So normally you have to deduct the tax like this. Okay. But if you are paying the tax, income tax, which is a tax payable by ST, so this tax payable, listen very carefully, if this tax payable is interpreted as TDS, so what you have to say is that you have to pay 50 lakhs, it will be 50 lakhs minus the TDS, that you have to pay to the foreign person. Okay. Secondly, supposing if the KN pays to the income tax authorities the tax payable by the ST, for example, in that particular case, you will have to gross it up. You will have to gross it up, that particular figure. So supposing if your net payment of tax by itself is, for example, supposing for example is 50 lakhs. So then you have to do the cross multiplication and you have to gross it up, that how much will be the gross payment, then how much will be the TDS. Okay, so basically you have to check the language of the question very properly. You have to check the language of the question very properly, that how much grossing up, etc., that you will have to do. Okay, so we will have to give the answer like this. Okay, now KN pays Indian Income Tax Authority the tax payable by ST. So first of all, let us say that this is TDS, because TDS is also tax. And normally in case of international taxation, the tax rate applicable to the foreign company in the given situation will be the same as the TDS by and large. Okay, so 115A will be applicable, special rates of tax will be applicable, and you will have to deduct the tax at source. Is that absolutely clear? That's all. Okay, now the second part of the question. Okay, now the second part of the question is, there is no agreement as to KN bearing the tax liability. There is no agreement, okay, as to KN bearing the tax liability. The royalty payable is decided to be 59 lakhs net of taxes. Now it is clearly printed that you are paying it net of taxes. Is that clear? That means you are making net payment of 59 lakhs of rupees. So basically you'll have to gross it up. It's just the cross multiplication that you'll have to do. Now again, I just give an example. If it was 100 gross payment, suppose 10 was TDS. Okay, this was 90. It was a net payment. Okay, if the net payment is 59 lakhs, you just have to gross it up and get the gross amount and the amount of the tax that should have been deducted and paid to the government. That's all. Okay, so this is what you will have to understand and interpret very, very precisely. Okay, so this is what is to be understood. So the first part of the answer given here, I am assuming that this Indian income tax is basically the tax of the other person only, but you are paying it on account of TDS, or probably if you are regarded as agent of non-resident, that means you are making a total payment of 50 lakhs and tax of the other person you are paying it, but your the amount of the know-how that you are paying is 50 lakhs of rupees. That is our first situation. Second situation, it's a grossing up situation, so it is 59 lakhs, which is net of taxes. Now as such, friends, the question is already over. I repeat, the question is already over. So this question, we have given the answer based on the situation. Listen very carefully. We are giving the answer based on the situation that there is no DTAA between the countries and this particular transaction have been completed. Is that okay? So that way our answer as such is already over. Update your answer fully. Now friends, suppose if there was a DTAA, if there was a DTAA between India and that country with which our SSA has got a transaction, suppose, okay, and the tax rate of the DTAA as per the DTAA, means as per the agreement which is signed, is 5%. Okay, say for example, supposing if such data was printed in the question, then what you will do? Okay, so in this case, section 90 or section 90A on merits will come into picture. This is a situation where India and that country has got a DTAA, and the rate of tax which is provided in the DTAA, I assume that, supposing if it is 5%, in that case, whichever rate is more beneficial to the assessee will have to be considered. So our 115A rate of tax, that is a special rate of tax, okay, or DTAA rate of tax, which is 5%, whichever is more beneficial will have to be applied. Okay, so supposing if there was a DTAA, supposing if there was a DTAA, and if the question would have printed, then the rate was 5%, then accordingly, you will have to give the answer. Okay, the second important thing that you will have to remember, friends, the second important thing that you will have to remember here is that in this particular situation, where there is a DTAA, where India and that particular country, the DTAA rates of tax, DTAA rates of tax, on that, there is no extra surcharge and cess normally, unless and until the treaty will specifically mention, I repeat, unless and until the treaty will specifically mention that this particular sum of surcharge should be adopted. In other words, if a question says that DTAA rate is 5%, so we are going to compare 5% with the domestic rate of tax, okay? But in the domestic rate of tax, we will have to consider surcharge and cess on merits. However, where there is any DTAA provisions, okay, on that we do not, because DTAA rates are understood to be all inclusive rates. Okay, so for the purpose of doing the comparison, we will not add 5% plus surcharge and the cess. That is something which I'm just trying to tell you. So when you're comparing 115A rate and DTAA rate, okay, for taking the decision whichever is more beneficial, okay, so you do not consider plus surcharge and plus cess. You do not consider with DTAA rates. Is that absolutely clear? And in the domestic law, that means our normal income tax provision, cess and the surcharge on merits are applicable. On merits are applicable. That is one of the key difference. Okay. So now update your answer fully. Supposing if your DTAA, supposing if it was applicable, then how your answer would have changed. Now, friends, come to this particular piece of the Barrett provision for your understanding. Okay. Now, see. Okay. Forget about this particular question now, but keep the answer handy with you, okay? Normally and broadly, there are two situations where there is a DTAA or where there is no DTAA between the countries. That means India and that country has signed up an agreement or not signed up an agreement. Either of two situations will be there, okay? If there is a DTAA, listen very, very carefully. Now, some theoretical aspect I want to clarify, okay? Now, supposing if there is a DTAA, then section 90 or section 90A will be applicable, okay? And these section 90 or section 90A, basically they are the duplicate section but in a different situation. Basically, if you understand one particular section, both the section is automatically just a replica in just a different situation, okay? Now, when there is a DTAA and this section 90, section 90A as such may be applicable, then some theoretical point that will come into picture, that why should a government sign up that particular agreement and what are the implications of this particular agreement. Normally, the effect to the agreement has to be given as more beneficially to the assessee. Okay, this is a general purpose conclusion which we have developed. So, if there is a DTAA, understand what is the purpose, intention, some theoretical aspect that why should India and that country sign up an agreement and the international treatment. Okay, now friends, see section 90. Okay, is a situation where the central government may enter into an agreement with the government of any country outside India. The central government may enter into an agreement with the government of any country outside India or a specified territory outside India. So it is a government with another government signing up an agreement. Okay, with respect to income tax matters. Okay, and some sort of relief, some sort of benefit is intended to be given here. Okay. So the purpose of relief, the purpose of giving the relief is one of the reason why these kind of agreements have been signed up. Okay. So question, a theoretical question may come that why did government sign up an agreement? So you have to say that these are the reasons to grant and relief from taxation, to avoid double taxation. These are all reasons why they will sign up. Okay. The second reason is for the avoidance of double taxation on account of income tax. Another reason is exchange of information for the prevention of evasion of avoidance of taxes, basically for the exchange of information, okay, for the recovery of income tax or the relevant corresponding law in that particular country. So basically these are the purpose and the reasons why India and that country will sign up to an agreement. Okay, now this agreement of course has to be notified in the official gazette, there is no doubt about is that. Okay, now the most important thing which is coming, okay, and mark this part also very valuable. In your material also, in your barrack also, you please do that. Okay. Now see, where a central government has already entered into an agreement, okay, for the avoidance of double taxation, the provisions of this particular act, that means income tax, shall apply to the extent they are more beneficial to that assessee. Very important point. To the extent they are more beneficial to the assessee. In this particular question, friend, I already explained that to you. See, the Indian rate of tax and the DTAA rate of tax. DTAA rate of tax was the concessional one. So then we have to apply that. Because India and that country has got a double taxation avoidance agreement. Okay, that is one of the very, very important point that should not be forgotten. This subclause 2. Okay, further. This particular provisions, the provisions of the DTAA, okay, this provision will be applicable notwithstanding anything in chapter 12A where that particular chapter is applicable. This chapter, sorry, 10A, not 12A, sorry, 10A chapter, this is basically chapter relating to the GAR, the avoidance of taxes. So supposing if you are misusing the DTAA, that means if you are misusing the treaty, in that case, they may not give you the benefit. So that is one exception. Okay. Normally. Okay. Further, another very important point that I want to bring to your notice is subclause 4 first of all. Okay. This subclause 4 says that if you are taking any benefit of DTAA, for example, Mr. X, he is taking the advantage of DTAA between India and Malaysia. Okay, so Mr. X is taking the benefit of DTAA in India with respect to a treaty which Indian government and the Malaysian government is supposing signed up. Okay, so in that case, this gentleman has to procedurally mention that a certificate of being resident in that particular country, which is outside India, basically in my example, Malaysia. So you have to bring the certificate of being resident in that country or in that specified territory, only then India-Malaysia tax treaty will be applicable to you. In other words, we call it as a tax residency certificate. I repeat, we call it as a tax residency certificate. So this is one of the procedural requirement. I repeat, this is one of the procedural requirement that if you are taking the benefit of the concessional rate of tax of the DTAA, then it is duty bound that you have to bring on record TRC, that is a tax residency certificate with respect to that particular country, and only then Indian government will give you the benefit in this particular treaty. Okay. And one last thing which I want to just first of all bring it to your notice. Okay. And that is this interpretation clarification of subclause 3, where any term which is not defined in the act, any term used, that means in your double taxation avoidance agreement, there is some words, there is some phrase which has used, but they are not defined under the act or an agreement. That means they are not defined. That means the meaning of those particular words, supposing it comes as a doubt in the matter of interpretation, in that particular case, okay, it shall have the same meaning assigned to it in the notification issued by the government in the official gazette. So you have to give the interpretation based on the notifications which are issued by the government. So that is one interpretation clarification. In fact, obvious clarification in this particular front, which has been provided by the law itself. Now, you can just turn the page and see the answer that we have written. If there was a DTAA, then we applied this section 90. We have given a concessional rate of tax. Okay. Now, if you want, you can write an assumption there, assuming that the assessee produces to the income tax authority a TRC, the tax residency certificate, in order to get the advantage of concessional rate of tax with respect to the DTAA, and accordingly, that particular note should be written in your answer. Now, friends, if you see section 90A, okay, section 90A is also a duplicate of section 90, so I'm not repeating that, but I'm just telling you that particular situation. Okay, now section 90A is also same duplicate of section 90, but it only says any specified association in India, any specified association in India may enter into an agreement with a specified association in the specified territory. So this is basically an agreement between a specified association in India and specified association in the specified territory outside India. And of course, it has to be notified. Other thing remaining the same. Okay. So it is basically a kind of an agreement between a specified association and with the specified association. In fact, and implication, everything is the same. So it's just a duplicate provision, section 90 and section 90A. Okay. So I once again, just a little bit repeat. See section 90A, where a central government may enter into an agreement with the government of the other country. Okay. So that is, the little bit of a difference in terms of the application, but that was section wise, intention wise, section 90 and section 90A, both of them are one and the same. Come on, friends, let us start with some more questions on DTAA. Come to this particular question. Actually, friends, this particular question is in our homework category. Come to this question ID number 4. Actually, this question is in the homework category, but let me just take it up for the classwork discussion. It's a good question. Let me read the question, baby. Come on. Nandita, an individual resident retired employee of Prasar Bharati, age 60 years, is a well-known dramatist deriving income of rupees 1,10,000 from the theoretical work played abroad. Tax of rupees 11,000 was deducted in the country where the plays were performed. India does not have any double taxation avoidance agreement under section 90 of the Income Tax Act with that country. Her income in India amounted to rupees 5,10,000. In view of the tax planning, she has deposited rupees 70,000 in the public provident fund and paid a contribution to the approved pension fund of LIC 32,000. She also contributes rupees 18,000 to central government health scheme during the previous year and gave payment of medical insurance premium of 21,000 to ensure the health of her father, a non-resident aged 76 years, who is not dependent on her. Compute the tax liability of Nandita. Okay. Now, friends, this is in fact a very good type of question which has got repeated in exam also 2-3 times. And a very good question. That was a simple question, but basic thing should be understood very, very properly. Okay. Now, Nandita is a resident retired employee. Okay. Resident retired employee. Now, in the international taxation, friends, remember one thing very carefully. By and large, the interpretation of the word resident, is resident and ordinarily resident. Okay. So some people do get confused. Resident means resident and ordinarily resident, or resident but not ordinarily resident. Okay. In default, let me tell you, when you read the interpretation of section 6, there the resident and ordinarily resident as such specifically is not mentioned anywhere. Basically, the reference is to the word resident, and interpretation as we do academically is resident as resident and ordinarily resident. Okay. So for that also, if you want, I will refer to some Barrett provision, but not now, but I'm just telling you, keep this particular note. It's a very important note in international taxation. Resident general interpretation, unless and otherwise provided, is resident and ordinarily resident. Okay. Now, Prasar Bharati, age 60 years. Now, because the age is 60, you are resident, you will get a higher basic exemption limit. Okay. So, senior citizen, whatever the benefit government has given, for the senior citizen, that senior citizen benefit will be available to this lady. Is a well-known dramatist deriving income of 1,10,000 from theoretical work played abroad. That means she has got the foreign incomes, and these foreign incomes is 1,10,000 rupees. Now it is very natural, friends, that because it was played abroad, the foreign country, the country in which she has performed, that country is of course going to tax this money. See, I mean, see, we are not learning. We are not learning the income tax of the foreign countries. Naturally, we are not learning. It's not part of our syllabus. But every country, friends, has a concept of accrual. Every country, friends, have basically the concept of receipt of income. See, what we have studied to the basics, like accrual of income, something like deemed to accrue, something like receipt of income. These concepts are very common concepts world over. See, different countries will have different grammatical language in their respective countries, depending upon their grammatical connotations. But something like that will of course be there. I mean, I'm just under general understanding. So this 1,10,000, which is out of some theoretical work, some performance which is done in the foreign country, will naturally be taxable in the foreign country. Okay, so if you see here, situation is like that. You have foreign country. In the foreign country, you have income of 1,10,000. Okay, because you have done that particular work in foreign country. Okay, in India you are resident. Okay, and because you are resident in India, okay, you will be liable for global taxation. That means you will be liable for Indian incomes plus the foreign incomes because you are resident in India. Okay, so you will be liable for Indian incomes plus the foreign income. So these 1,10,000 will of course be included in the Indian computation. Why? Because of your residential status. And on this 1,10,000, the tax of 11,000 was deducted in that particular country where this performance was given. So tax of that country is 11,000. So that is a foreign country situation. And apart from that, you have many other Indian incomes and Indian some deductions and all that, that will come into picture. So this is the stage, friends, where the double taxation have come into existence. How? 1,10,000 is accrued in the foreign country, and because it is accrued in the foreign country, it is taxed in the foreign country, and the same amount of 1,10,000 is also included in the Indian computation because you are resident in India and you are liable for global taxation in India. Your Indian incomes as well as the foreign incomes are taxable in India because of your residential status. All right. Now, so this is how double taxation come into picture. Then you have to see how this double taxation will have to be eliminated, because intention of the government is always not to do double taxation. That is the basic intention. Okay. So that the business can be sustainable. I mean, that's the whole objective to an extent. Okay. Now, see, India does not have any double taxation avoidance agreement under section 90 with that particular country. Now, India does not have, that is very important. So, moment you said that India does not have, this will be a situation of special relief under section 91. Because under section 90, there is no agreement which is signed up. So, this will be the situation of a rebate or a relief under section 91. All the basic condition of section 91 is satisfied. Okay. Now, they don't have any agreement, that's okay. Now, her income in India is X amount, and thereafter some ATC and all that kind of situation, medical insurance premium, some ATD. So, all that you have to do normal computation. Okay. Now, once you have understood this section 91, one second, I will just, let's go to section 91 and check it out. First of all the basic conditions are satisfied. In fact, time and again, I will keep on doing that because my students have to be well informed. Okay, now see section 91 condition. Section 91 is a situation where India and that foreign country does not have any agreement. So there is no agreement that exists. And the situation of section 91 is that you are resident in India. Okay, resident means resident, and ordinarily resident, general interpretation I'm telling you. Okay, resident in the previous year, you have some accrued income outside India. This is outside India. That means you have some foreign income. Some performance was done in the foreign country. Some taxes are paid in the foreign country. So you have paid some tax in the foreign country. Okay. And India and that country has got no agreement under Section 90. Naturally, because when there is no agreement, then only Section 91 will come into picture. Okay. Now, then you are entitled to a deduction from Indian income tax payable. So this is what you can call it as a rebate, relief, deduction, whatever name you want to give, you give. But technically it is called as a deduction of Section 91. And deduction is from the Indian income tax payable. So whatever is your Indian income tax liability, from that you have to give the deduction. So this is the provision. Okay. And this deduction will be given as a sum calculated on a doubly taxed income. Very important thing. So you should know what is a doubly taxed income. I already explained that to you, baby, in the past. That doubly taxed income is the income which is taxed in both the countries. That means that country also tax it and Indian government is also taxing it. Only that will be a doubly taxed income. Okay. At Indian rate of tax. So doubly taxed income at Indian rate of tax, or the rate of tax of the said country, whichever is lower. Whichever is lower. So you want the rate of tax of India and you want the rate of tax of that country. Then whichever rate of tax is lower, that lower rate you have to take it. Okay. And with that, you have to multiply with the doubly taxed income to get the amount of the deduction under Section 91. Okay. If the Indian rate and the foreign rate is equal, then of course, whichever is lower, the issue will not come because they are equal. In that case, you have to take the Indian rate. So this is only a simple clarification of the law. However, this is a pure logical clarification. Okay. So now, let us straight away start with the computation first of all. And thereafter, we will see how this doubly taxed income and a foreign rate and all that pans out. Okay. Now in all these questions, friends, as I've always told you also in the past, that wherever the tax liability calculation is a pure calculator work to an extent. Okay. So that you can keep on doing it faster than me because I'm pretty slow in doing calculator work. Okay. Now question ID number 4. Okay. Let's start with the computation. Make a note. Assess is Nandita. Age 60. She is a resident. Okay. And there is no DTAA between India and that country, which conclude. So these many facts conclude that you will get some deduction under Section 91. So this is a situation of Section 91. So this is actually, it is not required to be very much written like this, but for the students, no, so that you should know that we are solving this answer as per Section 91. And that is sometimes the students confuse whether we have given answer as per 91 or we have given answer as per Section 90. So that confusion students always develop. So to solve that only, I'm just making this particular note and the comment in my answer. Okay. Now let's start with the computation. Come on, quickly. These computations are pretty simple here. Once you have understood the fundamentals of the law. Okay. Now, see, from here on, her income in India is 5,10,000. So that we will take. In view of the tax planning, she has deposited 70,000 in the PPF. So this 70,000, we will give the ATC relief. Contribution to the approved pension fund of LIC 32,000. So this 32,000 will be your, again, ATC. Okay. She also contributed 18,000 to central government health scheme during, so this central government health scheme basically means ATD, that you are going to get this particular amount. Okay. So for herself, she has got this particular ATD. She is resident. Okay. And gave the payment of medical insurance premium of 21,000 for the health of the insurance of her father. So ATD for the parents. Okay. So ATD for herself and ATD for parents. Okay, these two figures you have. Father is a non-resident, age 76 years. Father is a non-resident. So she was a resident person. Listen very carefully. She is a resident person. Okay, but her father is a non-resident. Now, what difference it could have made, her father being a non-resident? Because her father is a non-resident, the ATD premium of a non-resident parents, okay, that will not have that particular higher limits basically. Okay, so but anyway, we are not crossing the limits of Section ATD, so we are not worried. But her parents was non-resident, who is not dependent on her, Okay, and although the parents are not dependent, but anyway, section 80D for the parents will be permissible. Okay, compute the tax liability of Nandita. So that is something that we want to do it here. Okay, so let's start with the computation. Okay, her Indian income 5,10,000. Yes, foreign income because of the performance is 1,10,000. Tax paid in that country is 11,000. Now, actually, friends, in this particular question, it is stated like it was a tax deducted. So, one normal note that you should always write, that tax deducted of the foreign country is basically the tax payment, or it is assumed that it is a tax payment of the foreign country, because normally TDS is not the payment of tax. Okay, so that note that you may write, that this TDS is not refundable, so that is as good as the payment of taxes, something like that. Okay, so that is 1,10,000. This is your gross total income. Give ATC. ATC PPF is some 70,000 and some 32,000 in some LIC schemes. That is 1,02,000. So this is going to be 6,20,000. Okay, ATD. Okay, for self and parents. Self and parents. And that is. Self is some 18,000, parents is 21,000, difference 479,000. Okay. Now here, this is your total income. Now you have to straight away start with the tax liability calculation. So give basic exemption. Now this is a pure calculator work, let's start doing it very quickly, but I will just develop the structure. Basic exemption is slab 1, 2, 3. 87A rebate on merits you have to give. If applicable, you give. If not applicable, you don't give. But this tax liability calculation is a pretty normal calculation. Surcharge on merit, cess on merits. Okay. You will get tax liability. Okay. Moment you will get the tax liability, you will get the Indian average rate. Okay. Foreign average rate. Now for that, if you want, you can write a note here. Foreign average rate working is actually not required note, but you can just write. See, this is 1,10,000 and this is 11,000 tax paid. Okay, this is 1,10,000 and this is 11,000. So you can do it orally also, but you can write one line comment there that average rate of the foreign country will now work out to 10%. Okay, so this is 10%. Okay, whichever is lower. Lower rate of tax, Indian average rate or this particular rate, okay, whichever is lower, multiplied with the doubly taxed income. Doubly taxed income also in the given question is pretty simple, because only 1,10,000 is there, which was taxed in that country, also taxed in India. So that is your 1,10,000. Okay, now we'll multiply with this particular percentage, you will get the rebate and the net tax liability. Okay, so please update the answer fully. That's all. No greater deal of complication now. Come on, update your answer fully.